Kasm Workspaces 1.15 is finally here, and with it comes a lot of new features and new workspace images. With each new release, you will likely see features geared towards multi-tenancy. We have kicked off this trend with granular level permissions. With prior versions of Kasm, you were either an admin or a user, but with 1.15, you have the ability to create a group with granular permissions. You still have the default administrators group, which provides members of this group all permissions. However, you can create your own groups. Here, I have created a user admin group. This group has permissions to view, create, and modify users, as well as view and modify groups. It should be noted that there is also a modify users admin, modify group if member, and modify systems groups permissions, which provide more granular control over what groups or users an admin can modify. I'll log in as a user that is a member of this group. You can see that I only have permissions to the user and groups panel in the admin UI. On the groups tab, you can see that I'm not able to see or edit the administrator group or users group, as these are system level groups. Modifying these groups requires additional permissions. Granular permissions allow organizations to create roles for their teams which provide only the permissions they require to do their job function. The new granular permissions are also applied to the developer API. Next up is multi-monitor support. Traditional container-based sessions can now have multiple monitors. If you're using a Chrome-based browser, Kasm can automatically detect your local monitors and position the new Chrome windows on each monitor and place them in the Display Manager. For other browsers, you can manually arrange your monitor layouts using the Display Manager. 1.15 introduces session recording. A new history page in the admin UI keeps track of past sessions. If enabled, admins will have the option to view and download recordings of a user session. Session recording is supported on container-based sessions and sessions using RDP, VNC, and SSH. You can use the aforementioned granular permissions to define which admins can view session recordings. Recordings are stored on an S3 compatible service and has been tested with AWS S3, Wasabi, GCP, and Oracle Cloud Object Storage solutions with S3 compatibility enabled. This is a licensed feature, so you will need an enterprise license to utilize it. New for 1.15 are customizable launch forms. Launch forms are admin defined and allows you to take input from a user when they want to launch a session. The forms can take input from a dropdown, freeform text fields, and password fields. If allowed by the admin, the user can opt to save their selections on the form so that they don't have to fill it out between sessions. In this example, I am showing off our new VPN desktop, available in our public registry, which supports Tailscale, WireGuard, and OpenVPN. The user input is injected into the container as a JSON file, which can then be utilized by a startup script. Launch forms are configured on the Workspace Image settings in the Launch Config field. This JSON field allows the admin to define fields with validations. It also allows for displayed fields to change depending on the selections a user makes in other fields. See our documentation on launch forms and our open source VPN desktop as an example. Links are provided in the video description. We added some new features around multi-factor authentication. Before, two-factor was either on or off on a per-group basis. Now administrators can allow users to add two-factor authentication on their own without requiring all users to enable it. Users merely go to their profile, navigate to the two-factor panel, and then click on Add Second Authentication Factor button. The next thing around two-factor is that we added support for WebAuthn. This includes a variety of well-known options including YubiKey, Touch ID, Face ID, and Windows Hello. Here I'm logging in using my MacBook's Touch ID. We have a number of new workspace images released alongside 1.15. The new version of Alpine and Fedora have been added, and Parrot OS has been updated from version 5 to version 6. We have a new Redroid image, which I will demonstrate in a moment. Spiderfoot is an open source intelligence automation tool set. Nessus, a commercial vulnerability scanner. Finally, we have our Bring Your Own VPN desktop images, which we've already demonstrated. Let's take a look at the Redroid image. You can see once again, we are using the custom launch forms to allow the user to select launch options. In this case, the user gets to select the version of Android to launch. When you launch a session, a terminal will be launched automatically that will download and extract the Android image. This demonstration has been sped up. It will take a few minutes for the download and extraction to occur, and for the emulator to come up and be responsive. There were a number of other features in this release. Cloud storage mapping is now available on Windows, finer control over cloud auto-scaling for AWS and OCI, a more mobile-friendly in-session control panel, a group setting to automatically add local users to a group on login. Group membership is now passed to the Windows agent for session startup scripts. There were a number of other features and bugs addressed in this release. See our release notes for complete details.